Bonsoir, mesdames et messieurs. On m'a demandé de faire l'introduction et j'avoue que pour un général à la retraite et un apprenti politicien, essayer d'être bref, c'est certainement pas ma force. Mais je vais tenter de me limiter tout de même pour vous donner un peu un aperçu de notre invité ce soir. Et de préparer un peu de terrain. On Parliament Hill was able to create what is called the Genocide Prevention Group that is bringing all members of all parties and both houses together to inform Parliament on mass atrocities and ultimately genocide and how they can hopefully through knowing more of what is happening in such circumstances, be participatory in their caucuses and in their parties in influencing policy. And so in under that rubric, the Monsieur Procureur, Mr. Jallow, was invited also by here, the university, and we are happy to do, in fact, work with the center in regards to when we have eminent persons coming through to have more people learn and also be informed and be participatory in an exchange with such gentlemen. I think that it is of great significance that now that we're in the 20th anniversary year of the genocide in Rwanda, that we have such a gentleman who's been, in fact, for the last 10 years, the chief prosecutor of the Rwandan International Tribunal. And with that depth, it is extraordinary that he, first of all, not only masters the international realm of how international justice should evolve and continue, but he's also maintained a sense of humor. Now, with that, he is a eminent academic from Gambia. He held several posts, both political and also judicial, as being member of the Supreme Court. Was involved with the International Tribunal in Sierra Leone, if you remember that one, and then moved on to now the still the ebbing part of the International Tribunal in Rwanda. But what is quite pertinent is the fact that this tribunal is not sort of going to just end. And it was interesting yesterday on the Parliament Hill when the question was asked about, you know, what's going to happen when the court closes. And Mr. Jallow said it's rather an unusual circumstance that a court actually closes. Just think here, how many of our courts actually close? That really doesn't happen. But in the international sphere, a court that might close without leaving a legacy, without being a reference, without lessons learned, would be catastrophic. And, 3 weeks ago, I was in Sierra Leone, and that court is now creating a museum, an archival capability, and is going to be a reference that we hope international academics and those who want to advance the ability of fighting impunity by having international criminal courts and also international justice that can pursue the very bad of people and bring them to justice. So as prosecutor, Mr. Jallow has also been given the added task, and I'll read it if I may, in 2012 was appointed to concurrently hold for a four-year term as chief prosecutor of the International Residual Mechanism for Criminal Tribunals, the successor tribunal to the ICTY and the ICTR. And that, of course, would be ICC. To me, gives me a lot of confidence that this has not been a punctual affair by the international community, but it is something that we want to pursue, and I hope ad vitam aeternam. Mm-hmm. However, I've already spoken too long, would love to speak more, but because I can't use PowerPoint, I will terminate this and turn the podium over to Prosecutor Jallow. Thank you, sir, for being with us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Oh, I don't think you do.
I have. Well, bonsoir to everybody, and bienvenue also. I don't have much confidence in my French after that, beyond that. It's a pleasure to be here with my colleague, Cheikh Bangura, who is my special assistant in Arusha. I'd like to seize the opportunity to thank the university for inviting me to share with you our experiences. I'd like to thank my friend and colleague, Senator General, whose organization has arranged all these meetings that we've had here, facilitated our mission here tremendously. The past few months have been very difficult for the cause of international criminal justice. I'm sure you've been following in the media the issues about the Kenyan cases, proposals for deferral of the cases, threats of withdrawal from the system, proposals for immunity for certain levels of personalities, etc. So serious that it really was a matter of great concern to many people who are committed to the cause of accountability and to many of the people who are working in these tribunals. It seems that we were at a crisis point and that we were almost going to undercut all the tremendous work that had been undertaken by the ad hoc tribunals in the past two decades. Fortunately, that crisis seems to be behind us at the moment, following the last meeting of the Assembly of States Parties to the Rome Statute. It seems that crisis is behind us, but nonetheless, challenges do lie ahead. Challenges do lie ahead for us in the realm of accountability through the process of international criminal justice. Today, international criminal justice has become a household word, largely because of the work of the ad hoc tribunals. The International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia was created in response to the events, to the tragedy in that territory in 1994-95. This was followed by the establishment by the Security Council of the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda in response to that great humanitarian tragedy we unfolded in that country in 1994. Then we had the special court for Sierra Leone in response again to the strife in that particular area, the extraordinary jurisdiction or chamber of the courts of Cambodia dealing with the consequences of the Pol Pot regime, and we've had more recently the special tribunal for Lebanon, which has its own specific mandate. All these ad hoc tribunals and mixed tribunals, we call the Special Court for Sierra Leone a hybrid tribunal, as well as the Cambodia Court. They're in a slightly different category because they are operating within the structure of the state where the tragedy occurred, and they are partly part of the legal system of that country. So they're slightly different, but all the same, they apply principles of international criminal law, like the ad hoc tribunals. These tribunals came about half a century after Nuremberg. Between Nuremberg and the establishment of these four tribunals lies half a century of very little accountability for international crimes. Within a matter of 20 years, which is a relatively short period, I think these tribunals have achieved a great deal in many ways. One, in bringing to account together over 300 senior persons who otherwise would have escaped the process of justice. Former heads of states, the Milosevic, the Charles Taylors in the special court Milosevic in Yugoslavia, the former prime minister of Rwanda, Jean Kambanda, who was convicted of genocide in connection with 1994 tragedy. Several other senior military personalities, politicians, administrators, all of whom would in the past have been beyond the reach of law because the national systems would either not be able to or were not willing to prosecute them at all. That's been a remarkable development in this century. That process has had its own spin-offs. Now you have national systems trying to exercise criminal jurisdiction over senior level politicians. The tribunals also together, working together, have made an impact on the development of international criminal law. Within a period of 20 years, just two decades, the frontiers of the jurisprudence has expanded so considerably. International criminal law has come onto its own. It's a fully fledged branch of international justice now, with landmark decisions which are worthy of emulation of emulation at the national level. And here I want to refer specifically, for instance, to the landmark decisions in Arusha by the ICTR in the Akayesu case in relation to sexual violence. The ICTR has made tremendous progress in that respect in terms of the redefinition of the crime of genocide, of rape, in terms of recognition that the crime of rape can constitute genocide, in terms of holding to account senior people, politicians, military leaders, holding them to account for acts of rape and sexual violence committed by their subordinates and having them convicted and sentenced for those offenses. And in terms also of the practical aspects, the techniques for investigating and prosecuting these crimes. So there's a vast body of jurisprudence which these tribunals have developed. Beyond that too, they have between them developed a number of best practices, techniques in the investigation and prosecution of these crimes. It's a complex, very complex, difficult process, full of challenges, as we are beginning to understand, looking at the cases that are before the ICC. But nonetheless, these tribunals working together have developed some techniques covering all aspects of their work, which again provide some lessons for national systems and provide lessons as well for the International Criminal Court. But beyond all this, I think, the most important contribution of these tribunals has been in establishing the acceptability of international criminal justice. The tribunals, through their work, have demonstrated that the process of legal accountability at the international level is possible. It can be done. And that it is necessary in the interest of justice, in the interest of peace, both national and international peace. And it is that sort of demonstration in the confidence of the process, I believe, which has encouraged the international community to move on this phase, move away from the phase of ad hoc systems to a more permanent system of that international criminal court under the whole statute. I think that's a major contribution that has come from these tribunals. Rwanda, the ICTR, that is the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, has been part of that process. I think we're all familiar with what happened in Rwanda in 1994. In over a period of 100 days, there was a humanitarian tragedy, perhaps the worst of modern history, of modern times. In just 100 days, up to 1 million people were slaughtered simply because of their ethnicity, men, women, and children, people who were not involved in conflict at all. There was a conflict ongoing between the RPF and the soldiers. But those who paid for that were the innocent men, women, and children who were not part of that conflict. An international community which was reluctant or helpless to put a stop to this responded with the establishment of the ICTR. Canada, of course, has played a very important role in various ways in trying to deal with that tragedy. Canada through its illustrious son, such as Senator Dallaire here, made all efforts to first prevent the occurrence of that tragedy. And when those attempts have been unsuccessful, Canada has responded in several other ways to ensure that those who carried out the atrocities are brought to account. Several Canadians have served and continue to serve the Tribunal for Rwanda in very illustrious ways. We had a second prosecutor, Louise Abo, was from this country. The country provided that. Many of our senior investigators, senior lawyers have come from this country as well. Canada has also been very supportive financially and materially to the ICTR to ensure that our operations can go on smoothly without serious obstacles. Beyond that, Canada has also been involved in the local investigation and prosecution of this crime, including the deportation and extradition of persons from this territory who are suspected to have been engaged in such offences. And in that way, it has been pointing to the future, that the future of international criminal justice really lies with the national jurisdictions. National jurisdictions have the primary responsibility and the ability to carry out this task of criminal prosecution for international crimes. We are very thankful to the people of this country for its history of sons and daughters, for the service that they have rendered to the ICTR. 2 decades after its establishment, we are about to close the ICTR. We indicted some 93 persons. And you would be right to think or to say that's a drop in the ocean of perpetrators. There were thousands of people involved. But then, of course, that is one of the shortcomings of any international criminal justice. We cannot prosecute everybody. We can only focus on those who play a leading role and leave the rest to be dealt with by the national system. So based on certain objective criteria, we were able to select these 93 targets. And they were top-level figures, starting from, as I said, the Prime Minister and going downwards. People who would not otherwise have been prosecuted. And the point of it was the fact that none of them was in Rwanda after the genocide. They had all fled and sought and found refuge in various parts of the world. Sometimes, mostly, of course, they changed their identities. They bought or secured protection from local authorities or local personalities. They went to inaccessible places, etc., which all made it difficult to look for them. But they were high-level personalities. And the fact that it wasn't until a year or so ago that Rwanda was able to secure extradition of persons to its territory for trial was an indication that without the intervention of the court, these people would have escaped punishment, because nobody would have extradited them to Rwanda, and they would have gone scot-free. And very often, like people who run away from extradition, they choose territories where there are jurisdictional gaps, and they end up being neither extraditable nor triable in the territory concerned. So the small numbers is more than made up for, not only by the status, the level of the perpetrators of these 93, but by the fact that without the intervention of the tribunal, they would not have been brought to account. They were put out of the equation by the tribunal, and this also then had the effect of assisting Rwanda to settle down and to restore stability to that particular area. So we have indicted 93, we finished the case, all the cases at first instance. We secured convictions, except in the case of 12 of them. 12 were acquitted and discharged. The rest have been convicted, and their cases are on appeal. We have transferred 8 cases to Rwanda for trial so far, and 2 cases to France for trial. We are an ad hoc court, not a permanent court, That means we have a timeline for closure. We expect that by the end of next year, we would have finished the appeals which are arising from these trials, and that by, except for one case, that is the Butare case, which will end in the middle of 2015. So come 2015, June to September, we expect the ICTR to close. Would it have done a good job by then, despite the challenges it faced? Well, first, the challenges. You know, an international court is unlike a domestic court. In a domestic court, the judge, when the judge signs the arrest warrant, he expects, and quite reasonably, that the policeman will enforce it, will go and look for the accused, arrest him and have him brought, and that his order for remand will be respected, the accused will be sent into pretrial custody. And when the judge issues a subpoena to a witness, the witness will appear. When the trial is set, the case will proceed. If he is convicted, there's an order for remand to a prison, and the accused will be sent to the prison. So a national court has all these structures, state structures, which support it and which ensure that its orders and its decisions are respected and enforced. International courts lack these structures. The judges will issue international arrest warrants, but the court doesn't have any police to enforce these warrants and these orders. It relies on the national police in each country to arrest those who have been indicted and to effect their transfer. It doesn't always happen. It happens most of the time. It has happened in the vast majority of cases. But there are always difficult cases where it doesn't happen, where either the persons cannot be found, they successfully evade detection, or where they are protected by the host country or by authorities or by people in the host country itself. And then you have a failure of state cooperation. If the accused is found, is brought in, then his trial will start. But again, you will find the lawyers, the defense counsel, don't live in the jurisdiction where the trial is taking place. The witnesses don't live in that jurisdiction, unlike in the national system. So the trial process becomes a huge international transaction, an international logistics exercise. You have to arrange for witnesses to be brought from one country or many, many countries. You have to, after having sat for the accused in many countries and brought him, you now have to bring your witnesses from all over the world, defense counsel from other countries, and then you get going with the process. What all this demonstrates, of course, is that the efficiency of the system is dependent on state support, is dependent very much on international state cooperation. If an accused is convicted, the court doesn't have prisons of its own. We have to enter into agreements with other countries which provides prison space for our convicts. States are not bound to do it, but many of them do so. And so we entered into agreements with Mali, with Benin, with France, Sweden, Italy. Though for Sweden, I used to say, Sweden has to be reserved only for those who cooperate with the Office of the Prosecutor. It's too soft a prison system to send any serious genocidaires to. So we rely on the prison facilities provided by states. If the person has been acquitted, then we have to negotiate with other countries in order to relocate them to those countries, because invariably they wouldn't want to go back to Rwanda for reasons of concern about their safety, about their security. They wouldn't want to go there. All this, as I said, emphasizes the fact that the international criminal process is very, very much dependent on the support of member states. By and large, that support has been available, but in some difficult cases, it is not there. Fortunately, Canada has been one of those countries which has been extremely supportive of our work in the ICTR and also of the ICC itself, as many countries also have done. And this is why it's been possible to track and arrest most of the 93, prosecute them, and deal with their relocations or their return, as the case may be. Managing the trials themselves is not an easy process. It's challenging. You deal with a copious amount of evidence. If you take the Rwanda genocide thing, for instance, you're dealing with thousands of witnesses. You're dealing with hundreds of thousands of documents in the evidentiary database. You're dealing with also with witnesses who are vulnerable. Witnesses who are vulnerable, the victims of sexual violence, witnesses who are testifying against senior persons. They are susceptible to threats, they are threatened, and sometimes they are influenced through bribes, etc., to recant or change their testimony. So the protection of witnesses becomes a very major issue. You have to find ways of protecting your witnesses. They are your building blocks. If you lose your building blocks, you end up without having a case. So you have to protect your witnesses. And in some instances, you have to relocate them and their families to safe countries, out of reach of people, some of the senior people you're prosecuting. Then we realize, well, we've indicted 93, but actually, can we prosecute all these people within the time frame we've been given? No, it was impossible. So we had to find other alternatives for dealing with them. And this meant us implementing our strategy for referral of cases to national jurisdictions. Our rules permit us to refer some of our cases to a jurisdiction which does not implement the death penalty, and which also provides fair trial to the accused persons. It's very difficult to find countries which are both we qualify in this respect and are also willing to take on the cases. Very often what we came across were countries which were willing but were unable, either because their legal system was inadequate or because they had capacity issues in the legal system. It was overburdened, too many cases, and the trials could not just take place. You are also, on the other hand, countries which had good legal systems, adequate legal framework, but for financial reasons or political reasons, they would not take the cases. And this happened very often for European jurisdictions, for instance. Because if you wanted to do a case in Europe or in Canada, you would have to bring all the witnesses from Rwanda for the prosecution and the defense. That's a tremendous cost. You have to bring them over here for them to testify, or you move the court over to Rwanda itself to sit there, or you have some video link systems in certain instances. But in the end, we were able to secure transfer, as I said, and also to Rwanda. Rwanda, of course, initially proved very, very difficult because it had the death penalty on its books. It had to be encouraged to abolish the death penalty, which it did. And that too was a remarkable turnaround in a country which had just suffered about 1 million murders. For it to turn down and abolish the death penalty was truly revolutionary. Because it was an act of reconciliation as well. It was an act, a declaration that, well, they've committed 1 million murders, but this ultimate penalty of the death penalty will not be applied. It will not be applied to them. And it was a magnanimous act. With encouragement, they abolished the death penalty. We worked with them to improve their legal system, provide greater guarantees for fair trial. We worked with them to provide training, capacity building measures for the investigators, the judges, the prosecutors, and those who operate the courts, etc. Up to the point where our judges then were satisfied that the system offered reasonable chances for fair trial, and so they were willing to transfer cases to Kigali for trial, and that's why these 8 cases were sent there. So we did succeed in this referral strategy. It through that referral strategy, the ICTR was able to contribute on the ground to the restoration of the rule of law and to the competence of the legal system of Rwanda. And I like to think that Rwanda's tremendous economic growth and the high rate of direct foreign investment it has had is not unrelated to the fact that there was this international judicial recognition of the competence and fairness of its legal system. I mean, investors go to countries where they're confident that in the event of disputes, there's a competent legal system and a fair legal system which will adjudicate their disputes in an impartial manner. This is a lesson not just for Rwanda, but for every country, that if you do want to attract investment, if you want to ensure economic growth, you must ensure that your legal system is efficient and that it is fair. But it's had also another impact. Canada was able to send Leon Mugesera back to Kigali for trial, and precisely because the ICTR had okayed the legal system of Rwanda. A number of other countries have done the same. So our 11 bis referral of cases to Rwanda opened the door for other countries to extradite genocide suspects back to that country to stand trial. Without that, they would simply have continued to live in those countries and not be brought to account, convicted. With the relocation of protected witnesses, with the relocation of people who have been acquitted or have finished serving their sentences, etc. And by and large, we have been able to secure a lot of that cooperation. But at the end of the day, of course, we have to close. And then you'd realize that closure itself presents its own problems. Because as the general has said, it's not every day you close a court. The Security Council said you have to close down the court. And then the question that comes up is this, well, what are you going to do in respect of all those people who have been convicted and sentenced to life imprisonment? And they're sitting in other prisons in other countries. Who's going to supervise the enforcement of their sentences? Who's going to deal with the issues of pardon and commutation of sentence when that comes up? And in fact, more importantly, who is going to receive their applications for review of their convictions when they say there is new evidence absolving them if the court goes away and ceases to exist? So the proposal to close raised quite a number of complex issues. And amongst them was also the issue of the archive. The records of the tribunals are very extensive, millions of documents, much of it relating to protected witnesses, in-camera proceedings, etc. And it just can't be released to the public or sent to any nation state. In the end, of course, the council decided that we will close, but we will continue in some form. The tribunals will close, but they will continue in some form in order to and to set up a kind of mechanism which will deal with these residual issues. So what we have then in place now is the residual mechanism for international criminal tribunals set up by the Security Council, which is an sort of ad hoc court. It has a very small contingent of full-time staff, about 100 staff only, covering both the Yugoslav tribunal and the Arusha tribunal. Only 100 full-time staff. And this compares with the 1,000 members of staff the ICTR alone had at the height of its operations. So it's a tremendous reduction. The tribunals will close, but they would have, I believe, left an important legacy. Not only the general one of the acceptability and feasibility of international criminal justice, but also a lot of lessons which need to be compiled, brought together, and made available and accessible to national courts and international tribunals which want to embark on the same route. Canada has been helping us in this particular area. We've done an initial compendium of lessons in the investigation and prosecution of international crimes. So more work is being done on preparation of manuals of lessons, again, in the investigation and prosecution of sexual violence, in the tracking and arrest of fugitives from international criminal justice, in the prosecution of international crimes by national courts. All this with a view to providing, as I said, in an accessible form, the lessons and the best practices that can be drawn from the work of these 20 years to ensure, as somebody put it so well, that the national courts and the ICC don't make the old mistakes that we did, that the only mistakes they make will be new ones, and that the old mistakes we made will be avoided because there will be lessons available to them on how to avoid them. But challenges, again, remain for international criminal justice. Much as we have advanced significantly, there remain many challenges. When the ad hocs go away, the ad hoc tribunals go away, there'll be only the ICC left. The ICC is not a universal court. It's a consensual court, treaty-based court. And only those states which are party to the treaty are bound by it. And only those situations, if it relates to a situation in a country which is not a state party, only the Security Council can refer that situation to it. And we know what has been happening in the Security Council. Some of the situations we need to go to the court are not being referred because of the exercise of the veto, because of lack of unanimity in the Security Council. So the major challenge that the international justice faces is the issue of universality. The ad hoc are fortunate, the ICTR, the ICTY, they are fortunate in the sense that they are universal, truly universal, because they are creatures of the Security Council under Chapter 7 of the Charter. And so all their decisions, all their orders are binding on all member states. That is not the case for the ICTY. It's not a feature of the UN Charter. Decisions are binding only on the state's party. So maybe is to make the court to work membership to ensure that the states, members of the UN, become party to it, and also universality in the application of the law, that all situations which deserve to be before that court are brought to that court, either on the basis of referrals by the countries concerned or states parties to their own statute, or on the basis of an acceptance by the Security Council of its responsibility to ensure that these situations are brought before that court. It is in that way that we can truly have a global system, an effective system of justice. There is also a second challenge we have. Our tribunals, Russia, Yugoslavia, etc., are based on the principle of primacy. They exercise primacy over all national courts. The ICC is based on the principle of complementarity. In other words, it takes cases only when the national systems cannot or will not exercise their jurisdiction. That means, therefore, the primary responsibility henceforth for prosecution of international crimes lies on national systems. But are national systems capable or willing to undertake that responsibility? We have to rise to the challenge of making sure that with capacity building and with political measures, there is ability and political motivation at the national level for countries to enforce these laws at that level. If not, if complementarity doesn't succeed, the ICC becomes overburdened with work. It becomes overburdened with work, and many of the cases will not be dealt with. If you take the situation in Kenya, for instance, in Kenya, there are hundreds of perpetrators who were involved in the post-electoral violence. But until now, we are only talking of four people being prosecuted. That is the four who are before the ICC. There is no talk of anybody else being prosecuted, either at the ICC or in Kenya itself, for what happened there. Yet these four are just the tip of the iceberg. Are we going to let all those other hundreds go scot-free? We have to deal with that issue. encourage capacity and political will at the national level. Thirdly, we must then also rise to this challenge of compilation of best practices, identification and compilation of best practices and lessons from the work of the past 20 years to make sure it doesn't disappear, to make sure that it provides now a strong basis for national courts and other international courts to discharge their primary responsibility for prosecution of international crimes. I thank you very much for your attention.
So let's open it up to the floor. Any questions?
I'd love to be the first one.
Yes.
Sir, there's been a lot of debate about the fact that there haven't been that many people prosecuted over 20 years, that there's been quite a cost of this. We've had the experience of a case here in Canada of a genocide about 3 years ago, I think, where we prosecuted one under our law now that we can do it, and it cost us $2 million to do that, that one case. I'm of the perspective that the fact that the court has been there for that length of time has given us depth in our pursuit of impunity by demonstrating that this is not a punctual thing, but in fact we want it to remain as an instrument, and we'll wait until we can get the bad guys to bring them forward. But there's always that business case exercise. Maybe a comment on that.
Yes, I mean, the struggle against impunity and for justice is a long-term process. It's nothing short. 20 years is a relatively short period in the process of international justice. And it's good that the tribunals operated for a long period of time. The length of time, I think, contributed very much to establishing this culture of acceptability of the process, to instilling this idea in the minds of political leaders that the prospect of accountability is something they have to take. It's something that must be in the equation when they take certain decisions. I think if the tribunals had been a hurry affair, done their work in 2-3 years and gone away, they would have been a very distant memory. End up being a distant memory. I think it was an advantage that they continued to function for quite a while. They criticized, of course, for the amount of money that is spent on the cases and also the time it takes. Some of the problems are inherent in the system itself. The periods for instance, the length of pretrial custody in the tribunals is invariably much more than in the national systems. But it's only because it's so difficult to actually implement a bail system at the international level. How do you release a suspected genocidal? Who will give you the guarantees that he will be coming back to court when required? You need this guarantee of a state where he's going to go to live in order to release him on bail. But states are reluctant to do that because they don't want to be responsible now for looking for him and ensuring he's arrested. A lot of the expense also goes to the requirements of fair trial. A substantial amount of our expenditures go to language services, to making sure that there's interpretation and translation. It postulates to the right of the accused person to follow the proceedings against him. When the accused don't speak English or French and speak only Kinyarwanda, Rwanda, then we have a duty to interpret the proceedings and to translate all the documents to ensure that there is a fair trial. Substantial part of the expense also goes to payment of defense counsel. Each accused has a right to counsel. And the UN system has to pay international rates in order to make sure it attracts competent and honest counsel who will defend the accused. This is not to say, of course, that it's not possible to reduce costs and reduce the time it takes for the trials to progress. And efforts have been made over all these years to deal with those two issues. But some it's an expensive and lengthy process. And the national systems may not be, the national systems which have tried to prosecute these crimes committed abroad have faced a similar problem. When they try to prosecute crimes committed abroad, it's as expensive as what the tribunals are doing. But those countries prosecuting crimes committed within their borders, international crimes within their borders, for them it is less expensive. The Gacaca system in Rwanda has tried thousands of cases in the years that it took us to do 93. The High Court in Rwanda has also prosecuted numerous cases and at a fraction of the expense. Again, that's a pointer to the desirability of building capacity at the national level, or maybe even at the regional, sub-regional level, for them to deal with these crimes and to reserve only the most serious and the most difficult for the international legal process.
Thank you, Mr. Prosecutor, for your presentation. I was just wondering if you might give us another extra word on the issue of primary jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. Some commentators have been talking about the end of primary